Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. My name is Camel, and today we're going to be taking a look at the 10 most hidden unique items in Skyrim. Now, by most hidden, I mean items that most people would never find during a normal playthrough, and would never know that these items even existed without watching a video like this or reading a guide online. Now, if you are into this kind of stuff, my other Skyrim Special Edition video links can be found down in the description, along with all of my social media links, and be sure to check all of that out after this video. Now, these items are also in no particular order, apart from the last one, which I believe to be the hardest item in Skyrim to acquire during your average playthrough. So, let's start with a simple one, the Woodsman's Friend. A very basic weapon right near the start of the game that is missed by so many. There is no quest to find it, there is no mention of it in-game, you simply have to stumble upon it while exploring the vast forests of Falkreath Hold. Just to the north of Pine Watch, there is an area of the forest that has been cleared out. The trees have been felled. At the base of one of the still-standing trees, however, lying in the thick grass, hidden from just about anyone who walks by here, there lies an iron battle axe. This is the unique weapon, the Woodsman's Friend. Now, if that wasn't hard enough to find by yourself, well, the fact that in the Hearthfire DLC, Lakeview Manor is built here, and the Woodsman's Friend will never be seen again, unless you picked it up previously. So it's close to impossible to find by yourself, and then the game will accidentally remove it anyway with a DLC. Now, as an actual weapon, it bears no enchantment, although it does do more damage than the standard iron battle axe. However, it swings more slowly than the standard iron battle axe as well, which actually overall makes it do less damage per second. So when compared to a standard iron battle axe, the Woodsman's Friend is actually worse. So it's probably for the best if this thing is tucked away in the thick grass in the middle of a forest, never to be found by the player. Secondly, we have an item that if you acquired, you're either super lucky or put yourself through a lot of pain. It's a unique circlet called Revan Sadri's Copper and Onyx Circlet. Now, to get this, we need to come to the city of Windhelm, where in the Grey Quarter, there is a merchant named Revan Sadri. When we go to barter with him, there is a minuscule chance that he will be selling his unique circlet. Now, it seems simple enough, but when I made the guide for this item, it took 9 hours of me saving the game, leaving the city, waiting 24 hours, and coming back and checking if it was in stock. It was completely random, and again, it took 9 hours of grinding before he sold the damn circlet. Now, please don't do this yourself. This item has no unique or interesting qualities other than its unique name, and perhaps bragging rights amongst your friends. But even though it is useless, its incredibly low spawn chance, and the fact that it's sold by a merchant that I don't think I've ever even visited before, definitely makes it one of the most hidden and unknown unique items in Skyrim. Now we have one I'm sure most of us have acquired at some point. However, how many of us actually found this by ourselves in our own playthroughs? Not many. I am of course referring to Windshear. And before anyone asks, I have a mod that changes the appearance of scimitars to make them look a bit more realistic when compared to the vanilla inflatable pirate pool party sword look that they originally had. But Windshear, this is hidden in plain sight, and again is a weapon I'm sure most of us have acquired after learning the location of it. So during the Dark Brotherhood questline, specifically the quest Hail Sithis, we'll be sent onto Emperor Titus Mead II's ship to assassinate him, which he may have set up himself. After doing so, we exit the back door and jump into the ocean and swim to safety. We want to get away from that ship as quickly as possible. Now, considering we are on the ship as an assassin and wish to remain hidden during the assassination, going onto the deck of the ship, which is covered in elite guards, is pretty much the worst idea possible, but the deck of the ship is exactly where we need to go. Now, luckily, after completing the questline, the ship is still there. Even then, so few of us go back to the ship, and even if you do, so few of you actually find this item. If for whatever reason you make your your way onto the deck of the Emperor's ship and decide to, again for no reason, climb up the bowsprit, at the very end, there is a sword thrust into the wood. This is nothing other than the legendarily broken sword, Wind Shear. Again, not hard to find once you've read on the internet or watched a guide on how to get it, but finding it by yourself is so unlikely. And if you did, good for you, I certainly did not. Now, as an actual weapon, it is amazingly broken and basically lets you keep your opponent in an infinite stagger loop with a 39% chance of paralysis thanks to the broken effect of the sword. This just means your opponent is either falling backwards or falling to the ground because they're paralyzed, making any foe a laughable fight. So perhaps it was best to place an item of such power in a hidden spot for so few to discover. Why it was the end of a ship, I don't know. Maybe they rammed enemy ships with this and staggered them with a 39% of paralysis. Maybe it's literally a wind shear and cuts through the wind so the boat goes faster. Who knows? I do know that I didn't find it when I played Skyrim for the first 400 times. Ah yes, now this next item is as sneaky as it makes your character. The Predator's Grace Boots. These are very hard to find by yourself. They are at a location called Hag's End, where at the end of the dungeon we'll come out onto this platform, where we have a bountiful end of dungeon reward with many items and chests to steal our attention and fulfill our lust for treasure and glory. However, off to the right we'll see a beautiful waterfall. Now we can actually whirlwind sprint across the gap from the platform to the land at the top of the waterfall, achieving our goal of reaching this hidden area. Now over in the corner, hidden from vision by some trees leaning on a rock and next to a chest, there is nothing other than the Predator's Grace Boots, a plot point you knew was coming. Now these boots are actually quite powerful. Not the best boots ever, but definitely worth your time coming to get, as their enchantment muffles the wearer, making us move silently, and it makes our stamina regenerate 1% faster. Nothing too crazy, but it sure is better than a lot of these hidden unique items. And while they are similar in effect to Dark Brotherhood items, if you are roleplaying a character that wants nothing to do with the Dark Brotherhood, then these Predator's Grace Boots are the perfect replacement item for the Dark Brotherhood uniform. Now the enchantment is also considered unique, and therefore sadly the Predator's Grace Boots cannot be disenchanted. But slip these on and you'll be as hard to spot as the boots were. Now we have one of my favorite weapons that's a right pain to find, and even once you know how to get it, it's still a pain. I speak of the Dwarven Black Bow of Fate, an item often considered a secret weapon as there is a lot of work that goes into getting this, and there is also no quest or mention of it, so you do have to find this all on your own. It requires us to obtain 4 of the 5 Kagrumez Resonance Gems. 2 can be found on the Reaver Leader in Kagrumez itself, 1 can be found being sold by Reavis Savani near Talmithrin, 1 can be found in Falbathaz in the final room on a plate next to the visage of Mazund, and the final one can be found in the Nechardak Aqueduct on a table in the upper northeastern room. At least one of the 4 that you'll need to obtain will be an absolute pain to acquire. Now once we have at least 4, we need to head to Kagrumez, where we will have to face 3 increasingly difficult armies of Dwemer automatons, all the while placing the resonance gems into the pedestal in the correct orders to progress further. Now once we have defeated the ridiculously powerful armies of the Dwarven Gladiatorial Arena, we can progress through to the final room and pick up our prize on the rack, the Dwarven Black Bow of Fate. Now with the right guide, it's moderately difficult to get, but trying to figure out how to do this all by yourself with no mention of the quest, or which order to place the Kagrumez gems into the pedestal, or that this place even exists in the first place, sure does make the Dwarven Black Bow of Fate a hidden weapon to the average player. Now as a bow, it's great and has an amazing randomized drain effect. It also boasts a unique appearance comprised of an overall gunmetal black and grey colour scheme, obviously contrasting the traditional dwarven bows. On the inside of the arms, it has a gorgeous oil on water sheen with orange and purple areas of shellac-like reflections and an astral chart-like pattern that slowly pulses orange. It's a truly fitting prize for such hardship and is definitely an item that most players do not pick up during their time playing the Dragonborn DLC. Next up, we have a sword that really flies under the radar and most people have never even heard of it. It is, of course, the unique Akaviri sword. Now, getting this is pretty simple, but to figure out it even exists is the real challenge. So, during the Dawnguard questline, we'll have to save a moth priest named Dexian Evicus. Once we get him safely back to Fort Dawnguard, we'll see that he is actually carrying what appears to be a blade's sword. If we sneak up on him and pickpocket him, we'll see that he is actually carrying the unique weapon known as the Akaviri sword, which lore-wise is technically different from a blade sword. Even then, it has a unique name, so it is a unique item. Anyway, to get this thing off him, we can either use the Misdirection perk in the pickpocket skill tree, which allows us to pickpocket equipped items, or we can use reverse pickpocketing, which is a technique in which we add a weapon of higher value into his inventory. Then we come back 24 hours later, and by coding default within the game, he will have automatically equipped the more valuable item, which leaves the Akaviri sword in his inventory unequipped. So we can now take it without requiring the Misdirection perk. So naturally, because we actually have to rob one of the main characters of the Dawnguard questline, the Akaviri sword is not an item that many people have, let alone know exist. Now, as a weapon in game, it shares the skin with the blade sword and has the exact same stats across the board, apart from the name, of course, which makes it unique. Now, in terms of lore, while the blades originated in Akavir, and the blade's weapons and armor are the same as Akaviri weapons and armor in style, it would appear that this sword has no connection to the blade's faction, but instead has been brought from or originated in Akavir, making it a pretty cool piece of lore, and a sword that not many players knew existed, let alone got their hands on. Now next we have a piece that most people miss and never find. This would be Auriel's shield. An absolute beast of a shield, having the ability to charge up and absorb the power of blocking attacks, which we can then unleash in a bash blast wave blowing enemies away. So how could such a cool shield go unnoticed? Well, it's found within the Forgotten Vale. This area is terribly inhospitable. It's like Blackreach and the Soul Cairn. It's an area that most players want to get in and out of as quickly as possible and not poke around. So during the Dawnguard main quests, we'll be sent to the Forgotten Vale and then eventually make our way to the Inner Sanctum. In here, there is a secret pedestal in which we must place the Initiate's Ewer, which will open a secret passageway into a deep, dark area of the Sanctum. Once in here, we will be faced with a Frost Giant, a cold and mammoth task for us to conquer. Once he's dead, on his corpse we can find the Ruby Paragon. Once we have this, we have to then backtrack out of the Inner Sanctum all the way back through the lengthy Falmer Caves to the other side of the Forgotten Vale to the Paragon Portal platform. We then need to place the Ruby Paragon into the slot, then enter the Ruby Paragon Portal. This will take us to a secret area called the Forgotten Vale Forest that is otherwise inaccessible. Here, hidden in the trees, there are ancient snow elf ruins, where we can find some Falma. Of course, we'll need to kill them, and after doing so, on one of their corpses, we can find the ancient Adric or even Anuic artifact, Auriel's shield. It's just so simple, really. I can't believe some people didn't figure all of that out on their own. Just joking. It's by far one of the most easily missed items in the game, and as an actual shield, it's pretty damn powerful. It's not the highest armor rating, but it has a super cool and unique effect. And I'm not sure if it's really awesome that this was so missed, or if it's kind of sad that it was so missed. Luckily, there's channels like mine that have guides. Now, not quite at the top of the list, but at the top of the world, we have the classic notched pickaxe. Once again, it's pretty simple to get, once you know how to get it. But finding it yourself is something not many players did, myself included. Okay, so once we reach a certain point in Skyrim's main questline, we'll be sent beyond High Hrothgar up the tallest mountain in Tamriel, the Throat of the World, to meet Parthenax, the leader of the Greybeards. It's not a short walk and faces us with pendulous cliffs, narrow, crooked pathways, howling ice winds, and a whole lot of excitement to reach the top. Once we do reach the top, we meet Parthenax and fulfill prophecies, save worlds, all that jazz. But where we meet Parthenax isn't quite the top of the Throat of the World. If, for no reason whatsoever, we decide to climb to the actual top of the Throat of the World, which is no easy task given there is no path and requires a lot of cliff jumping, well, once we get there we'll find a bunch of ore veins, but over at the highest peak there is a pickaxe wedged into the final spire. This is the Notched Pickaxe, the unique pickaxe at the top of the world, which is actually a double Easter egg. It also has a unique enchantment that fortifies our smithing skill by 5, although it will not take your smithing beyond 100. Now in the base game it can also be disenchanted, but overall it's not that amazing, but definitely useful to low level smithers. But the very inconvenient and weird location makes it an uncommon find in most playthroughs. Penultimately, we have an item that most lose the will to acquire. It's the legendary artifact of Morrowind, the Locket of St. Jib. Now most players either have no idea that this exists or they lose all interest in completing the painstaking quest to acquire it, especially considering that no great reward is mentioned in the lead up to actually getting the item. So to get this we have to go to the Solcairn, a place we'll visit during the main questline of the Dawnguard DLC for Skyrim. Now, the Solcairn, it's like Blackreach and the Forgotten Vale in the fact that it's an area most players wish to leave as quickly as they can. Very few players actually take their time to explore the area as a whole. And even if you do, you still probably won't get this thing. Now, if we do walk around for a while, we'll run across a lost soul, specifically that of St. Jib. Jib being the guy in the Elder Scrolls III Morrowind that you create your character name with at the start of the game. Anyway, he has been writing his opus, but has lost all of his pages throughout the Solcairn, and he will give us a quest to retrieve all 10 of his lost opus pages and return them to him, again with no mention of reward. Now this sounds simple enough, but there are no quest markers, and there is also no map of the Solcairn. So you have no map with no reference points, and you have to find 10 pieces of paper throughout one of the most unfriendly areas in Skyrim. Again, with no mention of reward. This naturally leads most players to happen to get this quest in the first place because you're just looking for 10 needles in a giant, inhospitable, violent, and unfriendly haystack. But if you do manage to get all 10 of his opus pages successfully and return them to him, he will reward us with a copy of his opus, but more importantly, with the Locket of St. Jib. Now, as a necklace, this thing is actually badass and worth the effort. It fortifies stamina by 50 points, it increases our carry weight by 50 points, and it also has a light armor rating, which makes it one of only two necklaces in the game to have an armor rating, the other being the Amulet of Articulation. But back to the Locket of St. Jib, it's definitely a worthy reward for our efforts, but the location of the quest and the fact you need to collect 10 pages with no quest markers and no map and no reference points makes it an incredibly rare item for people to acquire during their playthrough. And sadly, it goes unnoticed most of the time, much like the saint who gave it to us, St. Jib the Eradicator. But now this brings us to the final item, the hardest unique item in the game to acquire during your average playthrough. If you've completed the main questline, it is an item that we have literally all had in our inventory at one point, but we've had to give up to finish the main quests. This is the Dragon Priest Staff. It's a unique staff that shares its name with some other unique items, but this one is much harder to get and boasts a unique model and unique texture and a uniquely annoying way of acquiring it. So during the main quests to get to Sovngarde to defeat Alduin, we have to visit Skuldaven, where the portal to Sovngarde is. Now, for the portal to remain open, the Dragon Priest staff we are after must be placed within the pedestal. But of course, once the staff is removed, we can't get into Sovngarde because the portal closes. Now, when we approach the portal, the Dragon Priest Nakrin will take the staff from the pedestal, which will close the portal, and he'll use the staff against us during the fight with him. Once he is defeated, we can loot his corpse and take this Dragon Priest staff off him into our inventory. Simple, right? We got it. No, because to reopen the portal to Sovngarde to finish the main quests, we need to put the staff back into the pedestal. And once you do that, you cannot interact with it again. All we can do is head to Sovngarde and never return to Skuldaven. So how do we get the Dragon Priest staff then? Well, difficultly and specifically. The short of it is that when Nakrin pulls the staff from the pedestal, the portal remains open for a few seconds. Now, as soon as Nakrin knows we exist, he will go and pull the staff from the pedestal. So we need to get Nakrin to super low health, close the gap to Nakrin. The millisecond he pulls the staff from the pedestal, we need to kill him, loot him, and then jump into the portal in that 1 second gap before it closes. So firstly, we need to get Nakrin down to super low health before he pulls the staff from the pedestal. I did this with a super powerful bow while sneaking. Now, not only do we need to get him to super low health, but we need to close the gap and make sure that we are right next to him before he pulls the staff from the portal. You can use the sneak roll, you can sprint, or you can use whirlwind sprint. Now, once both of these things are achieved and Nakrin is on super low health and we're standing right next to him and the portal, we need to kill him the instant, the second, the millisecond that he pulls the staff away, which will begin closing the portal, of course. So as soon as he does this, we need to kill him, spam his corpse, grab the unique Dragon Priest staff, don't forget his mask because he can never come back here again, and then we have milliseconds to jump into the portal, which will remain open for a split second after he pulls the staff out. Now that I've explained how to do it, sure, it sounds doable and it is doable. But even then, it took me about 15 attempts before I managed to get this to work. So of course, you need to save the game before attempting this, and especially you need to save the game before entering combat with Nakrin. As soon as he knows we're there, he'll start moving towards the staff and pull it out. You basically want him to be on low health and be moving towards him before he even knows you're there. And this will probably take many tries before you magically pull it off. But once you do, bada bing, Nakrin, it's a good feeling. Finding yourself in Sovngarde with the unique Dragon Priest staff of Nakrin in your inventory and yours to wield forever. Now, this thing's actually pretty powerful and sprays a wall of lightning onto the ground that deals 50 points of shock damage per second. It also has a unique appearance, which sadly for unique items in Skyrim, it's pretty rare. So how does it differ in appearance? Well, all destruction staffs in Skyrim have a golden color and a much straighter shape to them. However, this staff has a more curled and curved look to it, accompanied by a dark grey and cobalt colour scheme, making it a truly fitting reward for those who manage to acquire it through some ridiculous magical means. It's fitting in not only power, but also unique aesthetics. And the ridiculous means required to get it are absolutely shocking, which has led it to being at the top of my list of Skyrim's top 10 most hidden items / hardest to find items, whatever you want to call it. These items are almost as hard to find as Happiness, aka the Elder Scrolls 6 release date. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, I've been Camel. I do hope you enjoyed the video and learnt something new about the Elder Scrolls 5 Skyrim and all of the crazy things that can be found within it. Be sure to let me know of which other items you think should have made it to this list of the most hidden, unique items in Skyrim. Now, if you've watched up until this point, you'll be very interested in checking out my other Skyrim Special Edition videos I've already done. Links to them can be found down in the description. Now, down there in the old description, you can find all of my social media links. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and Instagram. And if you'd like to support the channel in a more personal way, Patreon and YouTube sponsorships are available to you. As I'm sure you know, all of my time and energy goes into making these videos that I create for you to enjoy, so your support is most appreciated and welcomed in any and all forms. So thank you very much for watching, thank you for supporting the channel, and I will see you very shortly in the next video. I'll see you there soon.